I'm Rob Lucuria, senior editor at Gold Derby, here with Emmy winner Rachel Lee Goldenberg, who directed and co-wrote Unpregnant, based on the novel of the same name. Rachel, I'm always fascinated when I see a film on TV or in a cinema, when we go back to cinemas, where it's a novel that I hadn't really heard of. And I wonder, how did this director and writer come across the novel, and why did they decide to bring it to life on screen? So can you talk us through that?
Sure. So I was sent the manuscript by my agent, but the reason that I was sent the manuscript by my agent, just to dig into it right away, is that I had an abortion years ago and sort of didn't tell anyone about it. I told my mom, I told a couple of friends, but I mostly kept it to myself, and I didn't question that decision. It just felt like that's what you do. That's how you behave after you've had an abortion. You keep it to yourself. And then I read an article and sort of did a little more research a couple of years ago, and learned that as recently as the 80s, it was actually much more common for people to talk about their abortions, for actors to be on the cover of magazines saying I've had an abortion, and that in the intervening years, it's become purposely less socially acceptable, and purposely and that's led to more restrictive laws. And so that reading that article put me on a journey to talking about abortion sort of a lot, as much as I could get away with. And so I had sort of been on this journey of trying to be as open about my own as I can, because it's actually very common. And once you bring it up, you find out how many other people have questions or have had them as well. And so my agent had heard that. And so when she saw that there was a manuscript about an abortion movie coming out, she shot it my way. And then it felt like just a good match, both for the political message, and then also just the content as well was really appealing to me. So
yeah, for anyone who hasn't seen it yet, the film follows a pregnant teen whose decision to get an abortion leads her on this buddy road trip 1,000 miles across the country to New Mexico with her ex-best friend. It's a really specific story, and yet it's very accessible. They discover sometimes the most important choice you'll make is who your friends are, and that's what I think becomes really universal when you finish the film. I was wondering though, how important is it to you, and you've spoken about this already to some extent, it's to make this theme about abortion, especially for young people, more accessible, and I guess more commonplace or not taboo, and something that so many people have to deal with and shouldn't have to hide, particularly in certain states in America where it's such a big problem.
Yeah, I think that you know, my biggest hope with the film is that it can help normalize and destigmatize abortion, and that people of all ages, but especially teenagers, are watching it and feeling comfortable with the word and with the topic and sort of understanding it and knowing that it's not something to be ashamed of. And, you know, that's certainly the message and why we did it. But then, you know, in terms of what the movie is actually about and where we're spending our time, you know, the way to do that is to have a compelling story. And so that's the message. But then every day on set, I'm with the actors thinking about their relationships and that moment and what that character is going through, and not necessarily talking about abortion nearly as much as I am now.
Yeah, I can imagine when you're talking to media about the film, everyone wants to focus on the theme of abortion. But to be completely honest, I was thinking, you know, there's so much more to this film than that overarching theme that I really keyed into, because it, for my personal experience, and a lot of it is about personal experience when you're watching art, it didn't really resonate with me, and it hasn't yet in terms of the women in my life. But what really resonated with me was the friendship and also the relationship with the parents. And so let's talk a little bit about that. First of all, the film stars Hayley Lee Richardson and Barbie Ferreira. So Barbie, I was a huge fan of from her work on Euphoria, but Hayley, I was only vaguely familiar with. And by the end of the film, I've just been completely blown away by both of their work. And I'm wondering, firstly, What was it about each of them that led to them ultimately being cast in these roles?
Yeah, I'm so lucky to have the two of them, and lucky that they sort of got along as well and worked together as well and played together as well as they do in the film. Haley, I actually had worked with years ago. I started my career in like B movies and genre films and a bunch of crazy movies. And so I think it was maybe Haley's first or second movie years ago that she starred in a movie I had worked on. And so I had been just waiting for the right thing to do with her again, because she's just, you know, she can do anything. I'm such a huge fan of hers. And so this really felt like the right role. And it was a discussion for her to make sure it made sense for her, because she becomes the face then of this movie. And that's a certain amount of weight to take on. And then Barbie, I was also a huge fan from Euphoria, and she came into audition and my question was, because this role is so different than her Euphoria role, can she do this as well? And I just was blown away by not only how she sort of inhabited Bailey and how many sort of personal similarities she has to Bailey, but then on set every day, her sort of comedic instincts that I feel like we don't get to see quite as much of on Euphoria. I just was amazed. I could just give her a line and we could try it five ways and every way would be hilarious. So yeah, just a very lucky find for me.
Yeah, I mean, I always imagined, because so much of this film's success rests on the shoulders of these two women, and if they don't get along, but if there's not that spark, and I hate the word chemistry, but it actually is a thing. And so I just wonder, in the beginning of production, was there much work done to get these two actors to really gel so that the film would start to fly when those scenes between them were being shot?
Yes, that was certainly top of mind for me. The good thing was it wasn't a huge ask, because they really did. We did a chemistry read before we finalized the cast, and they just were so great to watch together. But then we spent our first couple of rehearsal sessions just hanging out and talking about their characters. And there's a handshake in the movie that they do, and I had them choreograph that and sort of mess around and do that. And even that process of sort of being physical and silly together starts to make that bond. They would do the handshake just separately around set sometimes. But yeah, it was a pretty natural connection, and we certainly did a lot of work. What's so important about these characters, because when the movie starts, they're not friends anymore, but they have this rich history. So we talked a lot about their relationships with their friends as they were younger, and sort of developing a language for what those friendships can be like and how they can drift apart. And there's a lot more to that relationship than you see in the movie, in their backstory, so that they're able to sort of draw on that and understand that closeness.
Yeah, and I think that gives them a level of authenticity that we really kind of buy into the friendship. Well, it's an ex-friendship, but we buy into their connection quite early on. Without that, I think the film, there was a risk there that it would not have been as successful, and that's probably very terrifying for the director, co-writer like yourself. the other thing that I really, really loved about the film, it's just such a joy to watch. And when you're exploring themes like abortion, especially for teenagers, you may have an apprehension as an audience that it might be depressing or it might be confronting. This film is so fresh and colorful and fun and engaging and immersive. I'd love for you to talk us through, for the untrained eye, like us, the audience, what techniques or what were you doing to make the film as fun as it is?
That's a great question, and I'll give like the couple minute answer and not the 2 hour answer. because I feel like what you're really talking about is sort of the tone, so we did script work to make sure that the comedy was all there and that the characters were there, and that was certainly my priority every day, making sure that the characters felt real. Some of the script work that I did was to give it as much visual adventure as possible. One of the things that really drew me to this script was the chance to play with all different genres in one film to feel like you're in a car chase in one moment and maybe you feel like you're in a sequence from Get Out in another moment. And so giving it all that, you know, I like to have fun when I go to movies. I like to see things that are entertaining. And so I was just looking for how can we make this as enjoyable to watch and go as deep emotionally, but then have as much fun as possible. And, you know, and so that was certainly the goal with the script. And then on set, you know, finding those comedic moments. And then tonally, this is something I talked about a lot with the actress, particularly with Haley, was finding the right version of how emotional this experience is, because there's a version where it's so dire that she's pregnant and everything's a disaster and how will I ever get over this? And then there's a version where like she has work to do. She has to get 1,000 miles. She's, you know, she's a really, in the movie, she's a valedictorian. She's very focused. So it's like, let's figure out the tone where we're busy and we're moving forward. And yeah, even cinematically, that's what I was thinking of as well. So I think a lot about transitions, because this is a road trip and we're propelling, like, you know, if you watch the film, you'll see a lot of thought put into how either musically or with the shot choices, we're kind of propelled scene to scene so that we're not languishing ever. We're on a journey, we're moving, yeah, we're sort of using the sound or just using sort of all the different cinematic techniques to like push us from one scene to the next. And, you know, and my job was to make sure that there was no time that we're kind of taking it too slow, that if, you know, that if we need to have an emotional conversation, maybe that emotional conversation happens on a crazy carnival ride. And so yeah, something like that is sort of an example to me of really that like the quintessential moment of our tone is like them having this sort of bear it all, very intense, very emotional, very important conversation as they're screaming their heads off and terrified on this ride. So we're sort of packaging it in an adventure.
Yeah, that visually engaging style and tone speaks to younger people. And this comes from an old guy, because younger people are, you know, the TikTok generation, it's not because they have short attention spans. They're actually really sophisticated and they like to consume entertainment in small portions that are really kind of rich and rewarding. And that's what this film, I think, does with its on-screen graphics, and its tone and its quick kind of pacey nature. So I think you really hit the mark on that one. My final question is not relevant to that at all. It's the one of the final scenes, without spoiling anything, but I found it deeply and profoundly moving to have Hayley Lou and Mary, who plays her mother, just kind of bear all and be super emotional with each other. And kind of at the end of the day, the film's about love and acceptance. Can you very briefly, because we're kind of running out of time, talk us through that final scene?
Sure. You know, it's interesting because that sparked from a note that I got at one point about, you know, a note that I sort of bristled at initially about needing to show different perspectives in this movie. And I, you know, and I was like, well, it's my movie, it's my perspective, what do you mean? But then I sort of started thinking about it from a character perspective and realizing that if Veronica does need to take this 1,000-mile journey, in order to do that, that certainly means that she can't talk to her mom about this. If she could talk to her mom, she wouldn't have the 1,000-mile journey. So coming from that point, I extrapolated, okay, so how does her mom feel about this? Well, you know, we say that she's very religious and that she would never get an abortion and that her sister has had a child very young. Veronica, Haley's sister, has had a child very young. And so then, you know, it was sort of actually pretty emotional for me to write that scene thinking, what would happen here? How would these two, what would Haley's biggest fear be in talking to her mom about this? What would the, you know, what would her mom say? And I really went into it with no resolution in mind. It was a process of like digging in as a person that's had various relationships with various people in my life. And you know, and where I landed was that most parents just love their kids more than they hate their choices. And so that's where I landed. And that was the journey. And that's what Mary and Haley and I talked about. And I'm glad it resonated with you because it's an important one.
Absolutely. It's a really great way to finish the film. And thank you so much for a great film. Thanks for joining us today. And we're going to bring you back shortly for our panel discussion.
Thanks so much. This is great. Mm-hmm.